Welcome students. Yeah, we were seeing about the excretory products and their elimination. On the way, today we will see about the countercurrent mechanism in urine formation. We know that the important organ in excretory system is kidney. The structural and functional unit of kidney is nephron. So, nephron consists of various regions. They are the glomerulus, proximal convoluted tubule, hellous loop, distal convoluted tubule, and the collecting duct. So, in this nephron, this countercurrent mechanism is occurring at the hellous loop. So, hellous loop consists of descending limb and ascending limb. So, around this hellous loop, there is another important structure, that is blood vessel, which is forming a round like structure. We call it as vasa recta. So, in this way, the vasa recta is arranged around the hellous loop. This structure is helpful for concentration of the urine. Here, if we see in the descending limb of the hellous loop, the glomerular filtrate will be flowing downwards, and in the ascending limb of the hellous loop, the fluid, that is GF, glomerular filtrate, is moving upwards. So, the flow of fluid inside these two tubules are in opposite direction. We say that as countercurrent flow. So, this countercurrent flow of fluid inside is enabling the salts to come out in the same way the water to come out from each tubules. So, the ascending limb permits sodium to come out, and descending limb permits water to come out. This descending limb will not permit salts to enter, and the ascending limb will not permit water to come out, or they are impermeable to water. One thing I want to say here, that is, all the tubules or cells of the body are permeable for water except ascending limb. And here the flow of fluid is just opposite direction. We say that as countercurrent flow. In the same way, in the blood vessel, or we say vasa recta, the blood is flowing. So, the blood flows in countercurrent mechanism or in countercurrent flow. Here, this is descending limb and this one is ascending limb. Ascending limb of the vasa recta and descending limb of the vasa recta. In the descending limb, the blood is flowing downwards, and in the ascending limb, the blood is flowing upwards. So, the flow of fluid inside the blood vessel is also in countercurrent way. If we see this flow of fluid between hellous loop and the vasa recta, also countercurrent. So, here you can see in the ascending limb, the glomerular filtrates moves upward, and in the vasa recta, the blood is flowing downwards. So, these two limbs are also in countercurrent mechanism. This countercurrent mechanism is very much helpful for urine concentration and the flow of salts outside and entry of water to outside. If we say the osmolarity of the fluid, so what is that osmolarity? The number of solute particles in a solvent, we say that osmolarity. So, this osmolarity, when the glomerular filtrate comes to the cortex region, it is 300 osmol. when it reaches the medullary region of the kidney, the osmolarity is 1200 osmol. So you see, the salt concentration from the cortex to the medulla, it has been increased. This is because of the flow of water from the descending limb outside, and that makes the glomerular filtrate more concentration. That's why at the cortex region it is 300 osmolarity and at the medullary region it is 1200 osmolarity. As the fluid is flowing through the ascending limb of the hellous lobe, again the salt or sodium is coming out and the fluid becomes once again 300 osmolarity when it reaches the cortex region. So by this way, the salt is entering outside. You should remember one thing here. What is the purpose of moving of salt outside into the interstitium? This is the important fact that is responsible for the concentration of the urine. As the salt concentration is increasing in the interstitium of the medulla, the salt concentration will pull out the water from the collecting duct. So here ADH acts on the collecting duct, which makes the collecting duct permeable for the water to flow out. As the water flows out, it enters into the interstitium of the medullary region. So this water is entering due to high concentration of salt inside the medullary region. Normally you can see one thing here. This is a beaker which is separated by a parchment paper, and here salt is placed and here water is placed. So normally the water will be flowing from higher concentration to the lower concentration. So in this side, let us consider side A and this is side B. From side A, the water will be flowing towards the side B because the water concentration is very less here. This is because of osmosis. So the same fact is occurring here. Inside the interstitium, the salt concentration is very high and it needs water. The water concentration is very low. That makes the collecting duct to send the water outside. So water is entering inside. This will occur until equilibrium state. So after that, what will happen to the water? We say that if the body requires water, this concentration or this counter current mechanism is occurring. What is the purpose of counter current mechanism? To increase the water level of the body when it requires. So if the body requires water, this mechanism works effectively. That brings the water from the collecting duct, and by this the water will enter into the blood vessel. So the blood will be now diluted, or it came to the normal level, and it will be transported throughout the body. So this is the way the counter current mechanism is very much helpful for the concentration of urine. How? Another point I want to add here. The concentration of the urine. If more salts are there in this interstitial region, water will be coming out. So that indicates the body is in fall of water condition. And if more water is required by the body, here more salts will be there in the interstitium. Water will be coming into the interstitium. That concentrates the urine. So finally the urine is formed. The urine consists of some 96% of water and remaining 4% is formed by other excretory waste products. So 100% urine is formed. Here, one thing we want to discuss here. If ADH is not secreted, what will happen? If ADH is not secreted or poured into the blood, distal convoluted tubule, collecting duct, they will send out the water passage. So this will lead to a condition we call it as diabetes mellitus. Diabetes insipidus. So what is diabetes insipidus? Increased amount of water loss through urine. And you may ask me, what is the difference between diabetes mellitus and diabetes insipidus? So diabetes mellitus, along with excess of water loss through urine, glucose will also be present. Then we say that condition as diabetes mellitus. And then what way diabetes insipidus is differing from diabetes mellitus? In diabetes insipidus, there is no loss of glucose, but excess water will be lost. And this can be corrected by giving ADH, and diabetes mellitus can be corrected by giving insulin. One thing you should remember here, injection or insulin can be taken only through injection, it cannot be taken by drugs. So this is the mechanism by which the urine is being concentrated in the nephron or in the Hellis loop and a vasa recta. This structure is very much helpful for formation of concentrated urine. Okay, thank you students. Bye.